Thanks, Robert, and the other organizer for the opportunity to present this paper that is joint with Massimo Delgato, that is in Pescara, and Chris Parmeter, that is from the University of Miami, and the title is Skill-Based Technical Change and Labor Market Inefficiency. So, what is the motivation of this paper? I mean, we in this work we try to stress that there are risks of potential bias that arise when the measure of skill-based technical change or other technology-related phenomena relies on information on wages, because information on wages may contain asymmetric labor market imperfection, and this could drive a sort of gap or wedge between the pattern of relative productivities with respect to relative wages. As we expect, this pattern is, this kind of gap is much bigger in advanced countries due to the welfare system. So our results and our alternative proposal show that even in presence of low variation in the wage ratio, the skill-based technical change may be still sustained. So, due to this gap that is created by asymmetric labor market imperfection. Then, at the end, I'll show a couple of counterfactual exercises that highlight in a fully competitive world what happened to efficiency or productivity or wage inequality if we eliminate this difference among productivities and wage pattern. Okay. I go quite quickly on that because it's very standard, and I mean all of you know very well. The standard approach of the skill-based technical change estimation relies upon CES production function with that sometimes is nested in a Cobb-Douglas with at least two kind of inputs for labor that are skilled and unskilled, and one or more capital input goods. And then you have the different technology parameter, neutral as the zeta one in this equation, or input specific as the A, U, and AS there. So the standard profit maximization give us the efficiency condition that when we replace the ratio of first derivative for skilled and unskilled, so when we replace the marginal productivity with the ratio of the wages, give us this kind of formula. So it holds only if, we don't need perfect labor market competition, but we need the symmetric labor market competition. So we need, as I show you in a few minutes, and was acknowledged in the literature, that the imperfection should be neutral between skilled and unskilled in order to run this kind of equation. Then, if this is the case, we obtain the specific A-term ratio, that is the technology in a point of time, the relative technology non-neutral in a point of time, just calibrating for some reasonable values of sigma that in the literature from Katz and Murphy and other is usually between around 1.5. Then when we run this procedure in two points of time, for instance, capital T that is the future and lowercase t that is the past, the rate of change of this measure gives us the skill-based technical change. So the measure of skill-based technical change. This is an approach that is adopted in a very large number of papers. I don't want to survey the literature because it's really huge, but it is just to tell that it is very accurate. It gives a quite accurate description of the wage inequality in the 80s or until the 80s, where, I mean, there are wage ratio that have been growing sharply, and people claim as the leading factor of this inequality, wage inequality growth, is increase of the demand of skill. Then some literature, well, the most probably one of the clearest paper that point this is Card and DiNardo, Journal of Labor Economics, show that in the 90s the pattern reverts. So the wage inequality is stable or declining for a lot of countries, And this is a sort of puzzle for the skill bias technical change hypothesis. In some sense, this is a sort of solo paradox, but in relative terms, because we continue to see advances in computer-related technology, but and we expect that are skill biased, but the wage inequality do not move anymore. So in order to detect skill bias technical change with the traditional approach in this scenario, we need a relevant inverse change in the relative skill supply, but these do not hold for a lot of countries. So, I mean, this is something that is not straightforward from the data after the 90s. One of the explanations, we don't claim that is the only one, is that this standard measure that relies on wages are likely to conflate the true skill-biased technical change, because if we have friction of any kind that prevent wage from fully follow productivities, this kind of measure is not a signal for the change of technology that affects one or more type of workers. Now, a very simple way to put things is consider that the firms face an asymmetric distortion that is tau, that in this case is increasing the wage of unskilled with respect to the wage of skilled. So this is something that in the labor market literature is called wage differential compression, or something like that. We could think to minimum wages or to market power for unskilled. I mean, there are a lot of ways to model this. If this is true, the same indirect approach we saw before has a bias, because this is an omitted term. And when we estimate the skill bias technical change, this is an omitted term that does not go away with that procedure. So the only way is that tau is not changing. If tau is changing, it means that the procedure is not accurate anymore. This is not our point. I mean, I would like, but was I already highlighted in the past by Caselli and Coleman or the book of Francesco Caselli. And they note that due to these asymmetric labor market issues, the traditional skill-biased technical change measurement are probably much more conservative for advanced than for developing countries. Because we expect that in advanced countries, there is this additional premium in the wage of a skilled. So our contribution is a simple empirical exercise that is based on a counterfactual non-parametric decomposition that based on local linear least square estimation. And so we advocate to estimate the skill bias technical change and more generally the change in productivities directly from the production function without relying on the wages. This avoids this problem and then allows us to compute this gap between productivity and wages, because we may use wages ex post in order to check how the two patterns depart. So, well, I just anticipate what are the results. We use WIOD data for the period 96-2006, and we found a very sustained skill-biased technical change, more than 3.5% per year, that is the driving force of the change in marginal rate of technical substitution. And given the relative wage are less or more unchanged in the period, as I show you in few slides, it opens a widening gap between wages and productivities. So we could ask ourselves, as we do later, okay, this gap means that probably the inequality is lower with respect to a fully competitive scenario, but also a more efficient allocation of labor could imply some gains in productivity. And these are the contribution of a counterfactual scenario we run later. Okay, so we use a very general production function in a log form where M describes our technology-specific inputs, so these are the returns of the input in some sense at the time lower t, And then we have a neutral technology that is the additive term zeta. So with a setting of capital skilled and unskilled labor. So we have just three inputs and we describe a set of returns that is the our technology M and a neutral an additive term that contains either TFP or idiosyncratic productivity shocks that may be specific to sector and countries. Now, in order to estimate the marginal product of skill, for instance, or another input, we compute the partial derivatives of the production function at that point. So the production function will be estimated in the continuous variable that are the input, but also in a categorical variable that are country, sector, and time control in order to take into account these neutral or idiosyncratic shocks. This estimation is quite easy to get the margin rate of technical substitution as the ratio between the derivative of the production function for the skilled and for the unskilled at a given point of time for a sector and a country. And so the rate of change is simply the ln of the margin rate of technical substitution in the future, capital time T, and with respect to the past, lowercase T. Now, this is not enough to define technology change because a change in margin rate of technical substitution may be influenced either by technology, asymmetric change in technology, but also by asymmetric change in the input mix, skilled over unskilled. So we need to isolate the last term. And in order to do that, we need a counterfactual term that is our tilde, our M tilde. We add and subtract this term to the former computation of the growth rate of marginal rate of technical substitution. What does represent this counterfactual term? This is the output that I could obtain in the past if I had the technology of the future. So I'm putting the stock of time lower t, the stock in 96, but I'm using the technology I would add in 2006. So if I add and subtract this term, the decomposition of the margin rate of technical substitution is in two parts. So the lambda part is the change that is associated to change in returns, that is in technology, ceteris paribus with no change in input. While the second part is the factor accumulation. If you believe that, for instance, there are decreasing margin returns, you could consider that the second term is negative because if you increase skilled with respect to unskilled, you expect that the productivity of skilled with respect to unskilled should go down. So in a textbook framework, I expect that the first term is positive and the second one is negative. To be more precise, we define the skill bias technical change as the relative productivity I would have with technology of the future, but input of the past, minus the relative productivity of technology in the past at input in the past. So the difference among these two terms is only given by the technology. It's only given by the returns. With the same procedure, I may isolate the factor accumulation term. Now, this skill bias technical change is quite clean because any log additive term that contains six neutral technology change disappears with the partial derivatives because it's the same numerator and denominator, so it went away. Okay, now one of the advantages of this kind of estimation is that we may measure the market distortion ex post. So ex post, now we have the change in productivity that is driven by technology. We compare it with the change in wages. And if these two are not the same, there is something in the misallocation on the institutional pattern that prevents these two measures to be the same. So for instance, a positive variation in tau is indicating that the relative marginal product of skilled grew more than the relative wage of skill compared to a skill. Okay, so these are quite standard data, and we use, just to remark, we use hourly wages, and then we collapse medium and low workers together, but in the robustness set we try other kind of combination, and I show you also this. So what does the results? Well, the results, if you look at the final row, show that the marginal rate of technical substitution was very strong. The change of this was very strong in 10 years. And this is almost entirely driven, almost entirely driven by the skill-biased technical change that is in the second column, while factor accumulation is very low. But quite interestingly, between non-OECD and OECD, the change in technology, the poor change in technology, is less or more the same. The big difference is the change in the factor accumulation term, that is negative as we expected in the OECD, while it's positive in non-OECD. Then if you look, the wages are less or more the same, it means that the relative decoupling or inefficiency, I buy some suggestion from you, grew during the period. Then very quickly, I show you a couple of counterfactual exercises. So we consider, okay, what happens if we eliminate the differences in marginal rate of technical substitution, so in misallocation, and then what happens if we let the wages fully follow the productivity? So what happened to wages inequality? Okay, the first kind of exercise, we consider two scenarios. One is eliminating all misallocation. So in all countries and sectors, there is just one prevalent marginal rate of technical substitution, that is the mean, as in Shea-Kleene kind of exercise. And in the second scenario, we consider, okay, we may eliminate intrasectoral misallocation. So we consider that workers may move only across sectors. So one farmer could be a farmer in another country, but not service white collar or something like that. So the output gains are quite sustained and are bigger in the case we adapt a skilled with respect to a skilled. We could consider some mixed strategy to adapt half of skilled and unskilled. So the change in the, you see that the actual growth in output is 2.7, and in all scenarios, this is much bigger. So it means that the misallocation play a role. Then for the wage inequality, we consider, okay, we know the wages in 95. What happens if we apply the growth rate of productivity between 95 and 2005 to the starting wages? So what happens with respect to the final wages? Well, I show you the densities, the dotted line is the counterfactual density. We see that probably lower wage should be still less paid than before because the productivity didn't grow anymore. So the asymmetric imperfection play a role in preventing from falling in relative term the lower wages. For instance, the change in Gini index is 6 percentage points with respect to the actual scenario. Okay, very quickly, I just skip you. I mean, we have identification issues stemming from the firm production function literature, only in PAICS and this field, because we should consider that there is productivity input decision are linked to productivity shock. So we build on the second step of Gandhi, Navarro, and Rivers Journal of Political Economy. And we consider that the zeta additive term could be modeled through a first order Markov process. In this case, we plug in this and we are considering that all the inputs are predetermined at the time t minus one. Results are less or more the same. We are currently working on a much more flexible scenario with no predetermined inputs and non-parametric instrumental variable estimation. So still I have 1 minute or two, something like that. Yeah. So this is one of robustness. Then we try other kind of definition of our skilled and unskilled, but you see that results are quite stable, especially for the skill bias technical term. I just want to show you. Okay, this is the change in densities. You see that the red line is the density of the margin rate of technical substitution that in 2005 is sitting on the right. All this change is driven by skill bias technical change. That is the blue density in the right panel, because the factor accumulation effect has a zero mean. Okay, I should be in time. So just to summarize, I mean, our proposal is to estimate the change in technology for the relative change in technology for pairs of input directly from the production function. It allows to take into account the presence of labor market imperfection and to look for the difference. If we use this approach, skill-based technical change is much bigger than detected in the past. For instance, there is a paper of Maliar and co-authors that review Krusel, Violante, and other paper of econometrica after 20 years, and they found 1% per year. We found that is much bigger. At the same time, the relative wages are not following at all productivity as we expect, and it means that if we are able to eliminate misallocation, there will be huge output gains, but the price to pay is probably an increase in inequality. Okay, thanks.
Thank you so much, Michel. Interesting. Who would like to start the discussion here? Well, perhaps as a starting point, so the skill bias technical change literature has a very is a typically more advanced country focused than and of course why it is more of a as a much broader set of countries. Can you speak a bit more on whether that's giving us useful variation here?
You mean if we have many more countries than
And also, well, further down the income spectrum.
Yeah, no, I mean we are considering a medium run, so just 10 years and quite homogeneous countries. So I mean the difference, if you remember, the densities of the skill bias are quite collapsed around the mean and are quite similar between the OECD and non-OECD countries, because in WIOD, non-OECD countries are not the poorest in the world. So I expect much more dispersion in technology, and at the same time, I expect also much more dispersion in relative wages. So, yeah, this is a methodological proposal, but in empirical terms, as you noted, we should expect a huge heterogeneity. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Berthold.
Yeah, thank you very much. I really like the paper. My question is probably stupid because I got a little lost in between, given the short time. So I understand how you can identify the skill bias technical change, but I was struggling with the interpretation. So once you have the skill bias technical change, there's the difference between that and what I observe in the wages. To what extent do I have to interpret that as misallocation? Isn't that just a residual that summarizes everything that could lead to a difference between the two? And I'm struggling to think what alternative explanation I have. I don't have any, so I don't want to challenge you, but I just want you to elaborate a little more on the economics of the interpretation of your decomposition.
Yeah, I mean, you are perfectly right. In previous versions, we call this a relative decoupling, because now there is a big discussion about decoupling between productivity and wage in absolute term. We are still thinking what there is behind, because probably it's not only misallocation, but is a box of other stuff. For instance, at the beginning, we considered some potential candidates. Misallocation distortion. So, I mean, I agree. Probably to be the most conservative we can, we could think, okay, this is a departure from productivity, but it's not all misallocation because probably you should have relative productivity ratio that are different between one sector and another, so we can't consider that it's so easy to have the same ratio or the same input mix in all the sectors. So I mean, I agree, this is the interpretation of this is not straightforward. There is not only misallocation. So we had a lower bound terminology in a previous version, so we just called it as decoupling, but then misallocation was in some sense what we did in the counterfactual exercise at the end. So
all right, any final questions here? Yeah, Federico.
Yeah, hi, thanks a lot for the interesting presentation. So I have a question on the estimation. So if there are differences either across countries or over time in the quality of the inputs, the skilled and unskilled labor, say due to human capital and so on, where would they show up in your estimation? In the factor accumulation term or somewhere else?
Okay, in the factor accumulation term, it can't end there because there you are considering that the factor accumulation is a difference on the productivity you would have with, I'm telling, for instance, 2 hours of skilled work and 1 hour in 95 and 3 hours versus one in 2005. So there you can't have a difference in the quality. And so probably if I got your point, if there are difference in the quality, it could evaluate the return, it could under evaluating the returns of the inputs in the skill bias technical change term.
Okay.
Was this your
point? Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You are right. I mean, if you are changing that, you are putting the same, you are getting an higher return. And so part of this higher return is just not technology, but is also human capital.
Okay.
All right. Thank you so much, Michelle.